Church. Welcome to the last Sunday of July. August is coming. Let's open in prayer. Thank you, Lord, for this day. Thank you for your mercy and your grace upon each one of us. Thank you for sending your Son, Jesus, to die on the cross and suffer for us, that we may have an eternal life, and that we can be your servants now, and we can be like Jesus, hopeful and glory. We pray right now that you'll have control of this service. Your Holy Spirit will just envelop each one of us, Lord. Speak to our hearts and guide us. Break up our fallow ground. Help us to listen to the word and implant it and believe it and apply it, Lord. We thank you so much for Dave as he leads us in worship and everything he does, Lord. Thank you for Karen as she blesses us with her playing, Lord. Thank you for Nancy and all the caring and sharing ladies and Karen and everybody, Lord. Thank you for Jen back there with the technology, Lord. Bless her and strengthen her. Thank you for the councilmen, Tony and Rich, and all that they do, and all the ladies that are involved in the Sunday school and everything, Father. And anybody else who has a ministry, Lord. We just pray that you'll anoint this pastor today, guide him and direct him, help us to listen, help us to receive and believe. Do a work in our garden, Lord, that we may glorify you. That will be less of us and more of you, Lord Jesus. And we'll give you all the praise, the honor, and the glory. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. If you haven't picked up a bulletin in the back, please get one. There's still one in the back there. Scripture reading today is Psalm 31, 23, and 24. Love the Lord, all his faithful people. The Lord preserves those who are true to him, but the proud he pays back in full. Be strong and take heart, all you who hope in the Lord. Praise the Lord. Dave's going to come and bless us with leading us in worship. Pray that you will worship the Lord with all your heart. Even if you don't feel like it, put up a sacrifice of praise and give him the praise he's due. In Jesus' name, amen.
Going to open with Great is Thy Faithfulness. Think about that for a minute, will you? Great is Thy Faithfulness. As the same as He's been, He always will be. Let's stand, shall we? Great is Thy Faithfulness.
Forever will be.
before. That was my mom's favorite song. And on their, we celebrated their 50th anniversary. I am one of 12 kids. 11 were still living with on their 50th anniversary, and my oldest sister was playing the piano, and her 10 others, 11 of us in all, sang Great Is Thy Faithfulness to my mom and dad on their 50th. Memory always comes back to you sing that song. Okay, a few announcements here. We met Jacob for the first time this morning. Here comes Jacob. He's going to join us. I see that big carrier when we had our kids. We had that little plastic thing that you sit on the car seat alongside of. We were up on the table. anyway, he's such a cutie. How perfect it's God's wonderful creation. How perfect. Okay, a few things to bring. Sunday, August 21st at the Torella's, that's our church picnic and baptism. We have a couple sign up for baptism for that. And then we did lose George this week. Thursday is going to be the funeral, but that will be for immediate family only. But the ladies will be having a reception downstairs afterwards. And after the service this morning, Karen and the ladies are going to meet to make sure things are in place for that, that the dishes are going to be brought, and so forth. What's that? Okay, the ladies are going to be meeting downstairs. So after the service this morning. So George was really, we met George the first time he came to this church. I don't know, 6-7 years ago, whatever it was, and he was really a part of us. Real loss. We need to just remember Marge, give her hugs, and keep her in mind as she goes through this tough time. But you never know. The Lord knows what it is, and we just need to understand that all in His time. Okay, Pastor.
Thank you. Well, good morning.
Good morning.
I just see Margie. He's talking about George. And I'll say this. For some of you wondering why you're not invited to the funeral, I figured I'd take an announcement and just let you know. George was a first responder. Now, anyone who knew George was a first responder, because that was part of his identity. But what I didn't realize is the family first responders were. I didn't understand this. If you're a first responder, you know. But if you don't, you might not understand it. But you've seen when a police officer dies, how there's lots of people coming to a funeral. Well, if a police officer, a paramedic, a fireman, or an EMT, well, George was all of them. No, he wasn't a paramedic. But he was an EMT, a fireman, and a police officer at times of life. So he has a huge family of first responders, and they show up for one another. If this funeral was public, there would be, my guess, if not 400 or 500 to 1,000 people would show up. I mean, if you knew how many trucks drove past this house with sirens on, and how many people were just showing their respects to George, yeah, that's why. So some of you, sorry you didn't make the cut, but there's thousands of people to break down to. So no, here's the thing. George actually made the list himself. And George sat down, and Margie and his and Bill were trying to make him put more people on it. But he was like, no, because they showed that this person has shown. Yeah, so he whittled down the list. I made the cut. I'm happy. No, I don't know what I would do.
Because you're doing the service.
Yeah. there's a subtle thing there. I wouldn't have made the cut. But pray for the family. Pray that, and I said this on Thursday last week, pray on this Thursday, pray that God will be glorified in George's death as he is in George's life. So pray for Margie, but pray for the service, and just let's let God be glorified as we celebrate the life of George on Thursday. And those who are going to help out, make sure you wear your Jimmy Buffett shirt. just move into prayer time. Obviously, pray for Margie and George. Keep Kevin and his whole family in your prayers. His dad, this Thursday, is that Wednesday?
Wednesday.
This Wednesday, Kevin's dad starts chemo. Ed, Kevin's dad, has a great attitude. He's hopeful and optimistic. Pray for family. I'm not saying they're not, but they're the ones who, we always say, with the physical comes the emotional. They're the ones who the emotional is affecting more than anyone, whether it's Dave or Kevin or Kevin's mom. Which one's it again?
Joe.
Was it?
Joe.
Joe? I don't think the other thing. So, Joe. So, yeah, there's so many things we need to be praying for about. Well, what else we need to be praying for about? As you guys see the list here, keep Karen Trill or her knee, her meniscus in your prayers. Yeah, Jack.
I have an announcement. My dear friend Donna, who's with us this morning, today is her birthday.
Now, Donna, this is not announcement time, this is prayer time. Announcement was 10 minutes ago. So, Donna,
can we pray for Donna?
No, you had your chance, Jen. Donna, what can we be praying for you about? She had her chance. We're happy to have you here, Donna. Since we are doing announcements and we're here, keep Donna.
Peace.
Absolutely. And during the meet and greet, let Donna know you're happy to see her here this morning. But since we're doing announcements, I want to let you all pray for. Our wedding was about a year ago, and there were two people who I didn't invite because they lived up in Massachusetts. I was like, I don't know if they're going to come down, or, whatever. But it's funny, two very close friends of mine just moved from Massachusetts to New Jersey. I heard it, I was like, whatever. Jersey, big state. Well, they're here this morning. Apparently, they live 5 minutes down the road. Eight minutes down the road. So that's Roxanne and Dave Lightfoot.
Good morning.
So keep Dave and Roxanne as they transition to back to New Jersey. They were here years ago. So you can pray for Dave and Roxanne because they may be looking for a new church. And and Dave has leadership, and so we may be looking for a new elder. So who knows? No. But keep Dave and Roxanne in your prayers as you pray for Donna as well. Yeah. What's up?
And if you get married again, you'll be sure to invite him, right?
I don't know. Crystal, should I invite him a second time? That's good. I had so many things I wanted to say, but with my wife sitting 8 feet away from me, I was like, go ahead. But ladies and gentlemen, pray for Ron. Okay. No, Roxanne.
David is looking for a job, so pray for that.
All right, absolutely. Keep David. Does Highland need any teachers? I think Dave's a little too qualified for high school.
Wherever he leads.
Amen. So keep Dave. It's also have Dave and Roxanne here. And it's also have Donna here. Anything else we need praying for? Yeah, Walt.
For the people in Kentucky, children and loved ones.
26. Is it 26 now?
26. And they said they're getting more rain coming.
March, you got
to go? Yeah, I just wanted to thank everybody for the amazing encouragement and support that you extended to Jim and John. It was just overwhelming.
Because we love you, John.
We do.
He prayed for Margie. He prayed for the whole family. And then you see at the top of the list, we have Dorian. Dorian's, even though she lives 1,200 miles away, she might be watching, she's still part of this body, and she texted Dave this morning to let her know that she's praying for Margie and she's praying for each of us. Joe and Helene, keep Joe in your prayers. He still has his ailments and his troubles, and Helene, well, she always needs prayer. she's probably watching. She knows I love her. And then Kayla, the whole Marino family, we can continue to pray for. Tony was here last week, and then Tina has had all kinds of issues as well, so keep Marino's in your prayers. Anything else? Anything we need to update one another on? Be aware of. All right, let's go to the Lord. Heavenly Father, we thank you. Oh Lord, we thank you that we have the privilege, the right to be called children of God, that we can enter into your presence and that we can approach your throne of grace with confidence. Father, we thank you for your mercy and that you care for our needs, that you condescend to us. And Lord, this morning we bring our cares, our concerns, our needs, and we lay them. Lord, I thank you for each person here this morning, each person online, each person that you brought out here for a specific reason. Father, we pray that you do a work on our hearts this morning, and that it's not about our agenda, our will, or our desires. We seek your kingdom, that you design, you put in our hearts, and instill into us a desire for your righteousness as we hunger and thirst for you. Father, fill us this morning with your righteousness as we seek your kingdom and your righteousness. Father, be blessed. bless this body. We thank you. We thank you. So continue to do a work with Albion Bible Church. Lord, all these prayer requests that we lift up to you that are causing distractions and causing fears and anxieties in our hearts, Father, we pray that you strengthen our faith through the ways you hear our prayers, that you encourage us through the ways you answer our prayers. And Father, this morning we pray that you direct our focus and direct our attitudes and direct our attention to you as you strengthen your spirit within us as you hear our prayers. So conform us to the image of your Son this morning, Father, as we worship you. Take joy, take glory, take honor, take praise. Allow us, Albion Bible Church, to bless and exalt the name of the Lord this morning. We thank you. We thank you. Lord, we thank you for this country we place and the freedoms we have. We get to worship you in spirit and truth. We thank you for these freedoms. And Father, we pray that you, Lord, we pray for our elected officials, that we lift them up to you, help them make decisions according to your will, according to your word, according to your heart. And Lord, convict them of their need for salvation. Draw them into your presence. Lord, we thank you for them. And we pray for them now. And Lord, we pray for this body that you brought together. We pray for your blessings upon it this morning. And that you speak to our hearts, that you speak to our minds, that you take joy, honor, and praise from us this morning. We thank you. So continue to bless out you as you have, as you provide for us the abundance, the opportunity to serve all the people. Lord, we thank you for the privilege to serve, the opportunity to go about doing your bidding, your will, as we encourage and comfort support and strengthen one another. We pray that you speak through us and you work through us this morning. We thank you. So your blessings upon this body. We thank you for it. And be blessed by us as we pray and ask all these things in Jesus' name. Amen. You guys have 3 minutes. Make sure you greet one another. There's 32 of you here, so it's going to take a while. So make sure you have your hat. You see in the house of the Lord this morning, and you have 3 minutes.
Three days before the vote. right here.
Ministering. Why does he get this beautiful mansion? I got a shack. And he goes, his whole life. Every time he drove, people prayed. Every time he preached, people slept. Now, the reason I tell that joke is because we're looking at Acts chapter 15, we're going to see two individuals, being Judas and Silas, and they go to preach a message that's very lengthy. And the reason I mention that is because, how do people respond? The pastor, people responded by sleeping. We'll see how you guys respond to our lengthy message this morning. So, but some people respond by sleeping, some people respond by praying, and are responding to it in action. And so we're going to look at Acts chapter 15. We're going to finish looking at how the results of the Jerusalem Council, and before we move on, but we're going to look at it from this perspective. So before we get into it, let's pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you. Lord, we thank you for the very words of God that you've given us, the oracles of God that we can learn from and grow from. Lord, we thank you for your word. Lord, I thank you for each person here this morning that you brought us out here. Father, we pray that you, Father, speak to us through your word, through your spirit, not my words, not what I have to say this morning. Father, speak through me. Put your words in my mouth, not my opinions or preferences, but what you have for your children here this morning. So speak your words. Put them in. Speak to our hearts, Father, as I tremble on externally. Father, speak to us and draw us close to you as you speak to us internally. So we put this in your hands now. This is your time. We thank you for it. We thank you for your word. We thank you for your spirit that speaks to us. We thank you for this body. So it's in your hands, Father. We thank you for it. We pray it all in Jesus' name. So last week, we saw the conclusion of the Jerusalem Council. We saw how they came to this decision that grace was by, that salvation was by grace alone. But by grace you have been saved through faith and nothing else. So they came to this conclusion after Peter and Paul and Barnabas and then James finally spoke and finished it up. They came to this conclusion that there was no need for Gentiles to be circumcised. No need for Gentiles to put themselves under the laws of Moses in order to obtain and receive the salvation, the blessings of salvation that came from the God of Israel, the Messiah of Israel. And all you do is put your faith in Jesus, the Messiah of Israel, and that's where you receive the salvation. So they wrote a letter out and they told, not only that, they came to this conclusion, but they also decided that there were certain ways, certain things that the Gentile church should do that would be beneficial. And they gave three things, or four, depending on how you're looking, that they had to abstain from. And we looked at this letter, they said to abstain from things that were sacrificed to idols, to abstain from fornication, and things that were strangled in blood. And last week we talked about the dietary laws and aspects of that, and how the Gentiles, how you Gentiles 2,000 years ago, were very gross in the way you did things. Good thing you had the Jews to show you how to keep things clean. You know? So, but 1,000 years ago, it was the dietary laws, the dietary approaches were disgusting. They couldn't have a fellowship. They couldn't have a unity. So they followed these, they said, to abstain from things sacrificed to idols, to abstain from things that were strangled and blood, so they could have this unity. You know, like we talked about last week, if you live in South, you know, what was it, West Virginia? If you lived in West Virginia, they probably would have to make rules. No roadkill at the Covenant Summit. You know, same thing. Don't bring strangled animals to our body here. But they also told to abstain from fornication. But they gave them this letter, and they sent Judas and Silas along with Paul and Barnabas back to church. Now this was a brilliant move. Judas and Silas being promised themselves. They were back in verse 25. It says that Judas and Silas, they were leading men. So they weren't elders in the church, but they were men who were respected, men who were intelligent, men who people followed. It would kind of be like if Albion was sending a letter, we would send Walt. Not an elder here, but he's a leading man. He gets up here each week and people respect him, people follow his opinions. So they would send leading men, and that's what Silas and Judas were. We don't know much about their background. Silas, we know a lot about his future, but not his past. It's Judas, same thing. Judas, by the way, he called himself Barsabbas. We know that because if you were lived in the first century and your name was Judas, you changed it. Right. So he went by the name Barsabbas. But Judas decides, and another reason why this was so smart, because there was a disagreement in Antioch. There was a disagreement over whether they need to keep the laws and follow, whether Gentiles need to be circumcised or whether they need to become part of Israel, proselytize, become Israel, in order to receive the benefits of Israel. That disagreement, Paul and Barnabas go to Jerusalem, and then Paul and Barnabas come back. It would be kind of weird if Paul Barnes goes, yeah, yeah, everyone agreed with us, it's all good. No, that probably wouldn't fly. So they keep, even if they came back with a letter and said, yeah, they wrote this letter and they told us that we're right. That probably wouldn't fly as well. But here, they have Judas and Silas travel the distance with the letter, and Judas and Silas read the letter and present the letter. So not only do they learn what the Jerusalem Council has, but they see it from the perspective of those in Jerusalem. So Judas and Silas also being prophets themselves encourage and strengthen the brethren with a lengthy message. Now, this lengthy message, I think it was had to do a lot with the things that Paul wrote to the early church in Corinth. So the early Gentiles, could be Ephesus, it could be Colossians, to the early Greek churches. Here's why, because it's very simple. This Jerusalem Council, this challenge, was not just to have them to abstain from things, but it was also a challenge for them to put the old pagan life behind them. You know, to abstain from fornication, to abstain from things sacrificed to idols. See, we see it so often, over and over again in Paul's writings, to the old self. You know, we've heard that term, put the old self behind us. We are a new creation. The old is gone, the new is here. We see, whether it's to Ephesus, to Corinth, to Colossians, Paul's used this term often. And we, from a 21st century Gentile church, don't really look at it the way that Paul is writing. See, when we think of our old self, we're like our old self is like, a lot of us have been saved most of our lives. The old self is like when we were 3 or 4 or 5 years old. Some have been saved for 30, 40, 50 years. The old self we don't even remember. But understand who he's talking to. See, he's talking to these Gentiles who were in pagan communities. They worshiped idols. Not only did they make sacrifices of food and harvest stuff to idols, but sometimes they would sacrifice their own children to these idols. And then they just gave into their impulses, their indulgences. Any feeling they had, they just gave into it. Whether it was their appetite to just eat and shove things in their mouth, or whether it was a sexual appetite, they would have sex with anyone or anything, whether it was children, or their indulgences, any feelings, any sexual appetite, any desires, they just gave into. And this was normal. This was normal. Not only was it accepted, like we have some crazy people in the world that we just put up with, we tolerate. No. It was the norm. It was the norm to worship pagan gods. It was the norm to sacrifice your children. It was the norm to have orgies and just to have sex with children and have sex with anyone or anything at any time because it was your desire. You feel it, you do it. That was the norm. That was what was accepted. That was what Paul and that was actually what Judas and Silas, in my opinion, were preaching about. Why they said a lengthy message telling them. If you pull up Ephesians chapter 4, if you look in your notes here, right. The council's decision not only promoted a unity between Jewish and Gentile believers, but it challenged the Gentiles to break away from the pagan lifestyle. In Ephesians 4, Paul writes to the church in Ephesus. He says, so this I say and affirm together with the Lord, that you walk no longer as the Gentiles. They are Gentiles! But understand how the Gentiles walked, how the Gentiles lived, the pagan rituals, the disgusting indulgences, the sexual immorality. Don't walk as the Gentiles walk. In the futility of their mind, thinking that it's okay, that they're just going through the motions of themselves, being darkened in their understanding, excluded from the life of God because of their ignorance. They just thought that was okay, the ignorance that is in them. Because the hardness of the heart had become callous. That those calluses, that you do something enough times, that whether it's have sex with a child or participate in orgies or sacrifice your children, you do enough times and you become callous to, oh yeah, that's just what we do here. The callousness. Having given themselves over to sensuality and for the practice of every kind of impurity in with greediness. Just whatever they wanted, whatever they desired, any indulgence, this is what they did and this is how they lived. But you did not learn Christ in this way, Paul writes to them. And I'm sure Judas and Silas were preaching the same things. That's why it was a lengthy message. They got there and told them that you did not learn Christ in this way. If indeed you have heard and had been taught, and just as you taught Jesus, that in reference to your former manner of life, the way that you used to live, the way the Gentiles now, that old self, that the former now, that you lay aside the old self, which is being corrupted in accordance with the lust of deceit. And so, and that you be renewed in the spirit of your mind and put on a new self, which in the likeness of God has been created in the righteousness and holiness of truth. They would continue in these things. And that's why Paul, it was just normal. Even after they came to Christ, it was just casual for them to still participate in orgies. If they came to Christ, it was still casual for them to get drunk and just give in to their indulgences and just still make sacrifices and eat food that was sacrificed to idols and just give in to these things because it was just normal to them. And that's why they had to be renewed in the spirit of the mind and let the Holy Spirit convict them of these things and make them realize. And the same thing for us. We have to put away the old self. Now, the challenge that we have, and like we said, most of us, we don't even think about what our old self is. We've been saved, some of us got saved when we were 4 or 5 years old. Our old self is what? You know, disobeying our parents? You know, the old self, some of us, our old self, we've been into church so long, we've been saved for so long, we've allowed the old self to creep in to the new self. And now it's hard for us to even distinguish it. Or we're new to church, we're new believers, and we haven't crucify that flesh yet. We haven't allowed ourselves to put the old self away first. So we're still living and we're still allowing that old self to creep into our habits. And that's one of the challenges I believe that we have. Is most of us look, hey, I'm not a murderer, I'm not an adulterer, I don't sacrifice my children, I'm doing okay. Right? I think most of us but we don't think about the old self. We don't think about the bitterness. We don't think about the anger. We don't think about the discontent, the depression. We don't think about these things that are not according to the spirit of his spirit. That we need to be renewed in the spirit of our mind. We may not no longer conform to the patterns of this world and just go through the motions, but we need to be renewed and put on a new self, which is in the likeness of God. I think that's one of the challenges that too many of us face, is we just go through the motions of our daily life. We don't look at the fact that these actions, these attitudes, these feelings, these negative passions, these thoughts I have, this pride, this anger, this bitterness, this discontent. This is the old self that we have crucified. I have been crucified with Christ, and I no longer live. But Christ lives in me. Like we said, the life I live in this body, I live in faith in the Son of God who loved me and gave himself up for me.
Amen.
Bing. Every time I hear that verse, I'm always going to think of the counter in the bottom. But, so, how are we doing? Oh, we're doing great. So, let's go back to Acts 14 there. And after they had spent time there, they were sent away. Actually, before we go, these individuals were prophets. If you go back to verse 32 for me, it says that they were prophets. I understand, we've said many times the role of the prophet. Now, we always think of the role of the prophet is foretelling, right? The prophet has two roles. Roxy, remember this my jazz?
Yeah.
But the prophet has two roles. Foretelling and forthtelling.
I know that.
The idea of foretelling is when we tell the future. That's what we all think of as a prophet, is foretelling. But majority of what a prophet does, we see if you look through the scriptures, is forthtelling. And what it is it's explaining God's word. And what God's will is, God's word is explaining it to the people. So this is exactly what Judas and Silas did. The words of God, the truth that God had through this letter, the truth that God had to Paul right through the New Testament. These truths that were already part of God's principles, but we didn't understand them because they were mysteries to the Old Testament. These truths, this is what that Judas and Silas were speaking. They were forthtelling. And while they're doing it, one of the things we see in 1 Corinthians chapter 14 is that we see prophets, but what one who prophesies speaks to men for edification, exhortation, and consolation. We would think one who prophesies judges and tells the future. Right? That's what prophecy is, right? Judgment, true future. No. The whole point of prophecy. What's so interesting is so often we see prophecy and people get scared by it. And we talked about this on Thursday, is that so often, and this is what the idea, when someone preaches to you, how do you respond? Because the prophets come to us with exhortation, edification, and consolation. But so often, if our attitude is wrong, if our thoughts are wrong. Now, look, I don't want to get into the discussion, debates of whether prophecy is still a gift today. That's not what I'm talking about. I'm talking about the idea of a preacher coming to you, preaching to you with edification, exhortation, and consolation. And so often, we get offended by it. And we don't have judgment and conviction. How do we respond? See, the prophets or the preachers, or even one another, our job is edification, exhortation, and consolation. We strengthen one another. Each one of us, if you are a child of God, you've been given a spiritual gift, a supernatural ability that gives you the supernatural, a divine gift where you're able to encourage, edify, and console one another. You, each one of us, have, if you are a child of God, you have the ability, you have the gift. And not only that, you have the obligation to use that gift to encourage, to edify, and to console one another. Each one of us has been given these gifts. In Colossians chapter 3, verse 16, yes. Colossians chapter 3, verse 16 says, let the word of Christ richly dwell within you with all wisdom, teaching and admonishing, where the pastor teaches and admonishes everyone. That's what it says, right? Where the pastor teaches and admonishes. So you, no, where we teach and admonish one another. With one another, with psalms and hymns and spiritual songs, singing and thankfulness and heart, with your hearts to God. We're supposed to be teaching and admonishing one another, correcting one another, encouraging one another, strengthening one another, consoling one another, edifying and exhorting one another. The challenge with that is, well, when I correct you, it hurts. And when you correct me, it hurts. And so we don't want to do that. I've said this many times, I'll use the analogy I use so often, that you guys have heard it so many times, and you probably get tired of it so many times. If someone has a piece of broccoli in their teeth, they have a piece of spinach right here, and you see the piece of spinach right there. Let's be honest. What do you do?
Tell.
Liar! Liar! You're lying! You're lying! You're all a bunch of liars. I'm going home. Most of us stare at it and feel bad. Most of us just look at it and go, well, if I tell them, it's going to be awkward. I'm going to make them feel awkward. I'm going to feel awkward. I'm going to embarrass them. So I'd rather just let them walk around with spinach in their teeth. If we don't do it when it comes to spinach in the teeth, my question is, do we do that when it comes to someone's spiritual walk? When someone has spiritual spinach in their teeth? I don't know if that transfers properly, but you all get my point. But we're supposed to be teaching one another, correcting one another, admonishing one another, encouraging one another, exhorting one another, which means bringing one another along and showing each other as we encourage one another. I'll share this. I'll tell two quick stories real quick. When I was a youth pastor, there's something I used to do. And pull Proverbs 25 verse, no, I'm sorry, 12:25. Proverbs 12:25. Every single one of us knows what it's like to be anxious. Every one of us has had fear, has had that trepidation in our hearts. Anxiety in a man's heart weighs it down. Yeah. We've all been there. Every one of us been there. When I was a youth pastor, one thing I used to do, I did it twice, I shouldn't say used to do it, play this game where we had, you know, all the kids sit in a circle and you hand them a paper plate. And the kid would write his name or her name on the paper plate. You know, they thought it was a decoration thing, so they're sitting there decorating and making it all artsy. And then once they finish writing their name, you say, pass it to the left. And then you tell them to write some, look at the name on it, and the person whose name it is, you write something nice about that person. Something kind about that person, a quality about that you admire, something that you appreciate about that person, something that you want, something good about that person, you write it on their plate, and then you pass it to the left. And as the plates go around, eventually it comes back to you, and you receive your plate, and someone's going, well, I don't really respond to praise, I'm not really one who needs encouragement, yeah, you can tell me, I don't need people to tell me nice things. You can say that, and a lot of teenagers said that until they received their plate back. And they saw all the things that, now, I know two, in the years I've done this, we've done it twice, so like 40 different plates are out there. I know two teenagers who still have their plates and look at it often. I know one teenager who told me, oh, she's in her 20s now, she told me that plate got her through college. the tough times, she looked at it and it reminded her and encouraged her to get it so that she was able to endure. See, we don't understand the weight that's in your heart. We don't understand the weights in other people's heart. But we understand the anxiety and the weights in my heart. Well, understand, that weight is on other people as well, and you can lift it. You can lift it with a word. The Proverbs tells us, but a good word makes that heart glad. Mm-hmm. See, we have this supernatural ability to lift one another up. We have a supernatural ability to encourage them. And I just want to tell one thing real quick. Kevin said when Roxanne walked in, I got the biggest smile on my face. I'm going to cry just thinking about Roxy. Because Roxy, she has validated me so much. Like, she just cared for me my whole life. Well, last 20 years. You know, so, and for her making me feel special, probably one of the reasons I'm able to be a pastor today is because those people who encourage me, those people who actually care, those people who say nice things to me. And I told story after story after story and about these things that people could say will lift us up. And every single one of us has been down. But we forget that each one of us has the privilege, has the ability, has the uncanny supernatural power to lift one another up. And that's what these men did. They didn't just share the word, they encouraged. They didn't just preach a lengthy message, they exhorted and consoled. And that's what the prophets did. So we see the response, and that, you know, back to the Acts. And after they spent time there, they were sent away from the brethren in peace to those who sent them out. But it seemed good for Silas and Peter. I'm not going to go get into the manuscripts of why this is in parentheses here, but some of your Bibles don't have verse 34. I understand that, and we could go into details and specifics about it, but basically what it's doing here is it's showing us that, because it says that they went back, and now, so this verse was, I don't want to say added in, but this verse is here so that we know that Silas didn't leave along with Judas. But I want to go into the Dead Sea Scrolls and the Latin Vulgate, and there's a whole many. Talk to me later if you guys want to know why that verse is not in your NIV Bible. Okay, but we'll talk later. But go ahead, Jen. But Paul and Barnabas stayed in Antioch, teaching and preaching with many others also the word of the Lord. This word preaching is deceiving. It's not the word preaching that we think of. It's kind of interesting. The Greek word, now I'm nervous. I know Dave knows Greek, okay? Yeah, I mean, I know you are Greek, but you've told me that your Greek's not that good. I think you probably speak fluent Greek, I am. So, yeah, you say just a little, now I'm nervous. But I'm not even trying the word. But it's where we get the word evangelize. The verb of evangelize. Evangelize, the gospel. The good news, when you preach the good news, when you preach the gospel, it's called evangelizing. Because evangelion is the Greek word for gospel. So when you evangelize, what's interesting though is Luke just called it preaching. I find that so bad. It's actually the same word that we see in Luke. What's interesting is this word evangelize is used 49 times in the New Testament. 30 of them are used by Luke. The first time we see it is in Luke chapter 2. Evangelize. You guys ready? Do not be afraid, for behold, I bring you good tidings. Same word as we see preached in Acts. That same word preached here in Luke, he says, I bring you good tidings. Bring of good tidings is preaching. This morning I bring you good tidings of all kinds of stuff. But what I want to do is I want us to understand our ability to bring these good tidings. I want us to understand our obligation to bring the good news. Most of us think that means preaching the gospel. Now, we know the gospel is the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus Christ. But the good news of God's word that Paul and Barnabas continue to preach, and many others as well, there's so many benefits. There's so much good news. So many gospel messages and gospel presentations that come in God's word. God's word, well, I'm going to tell you a quick story. Alright, so, Father's Day was 6 weeks ago or so, and someone brought us a message about the thrill in Manila. Alright, the thrill in Manila was Muhammad Ali and Joe Frazier fighting in the Philippines. There was Ali liked to rhyme his fights. Another fight that had a rhyme to it, you guys know what that one was? Anyone? The Rumble in the Jungle. The Rumble in the Jungle was George Foreman fighting Muhammad Ali in Africa. All right? Now, George Foreman, what was it, Mumbai? I forget the name of the city in Africa it was. But George Foreman fighting Muhammad Ali in Africa. Before George Foreman, 1974, before he flew to Africa, someone came up to George Foreman and handed him a Bible. First time in his life anyone ever gave him a Bible and said, here, keep this for good luck. That's what someone told him. Here, keep this for good luck. George Foreman took that Bible and he held it. Because George Foreman had a rabbit's foot, a four-leaf clover. He had a chain of that he carried around. He had lots of superstition things, good luck charms that he carried around. So he took that Bible, put it with his good luck charm, and he went and got beat up by Muhammad Ali. And when he lost that fight, he said, what good is this? And he threw the Bible away. He said it wasn't until 20 years later that he picked up another Bible because he realized that it wasn't about holding it. It was about reading it. It wasn't about believing up in it. It was about believing it. And he said now he realizes the Bible is not a good luck charm. The Bible is a roadmap. And see, he looks at the Bible now as instructions on how we are to get to where we need to go. And far too often we don't understand. We just go through the motions of our lives, and we don't understand that God is speaking to us and working to us, and he uses his word to speak to us. He uses his word to encourage us. He uses his word to strengthen us. We got to open the word to understand the good news of that word. And if you go back in Acts, they were preaching, teaching and preaching with many others also. It wasn't just Barnabas. It wasn't just Paul. It wasn't just Silas. It was the entire body as they were preaching and teaching and sharing with one another the good news of the word. What when are we having our testimony night?
September
what? It's funny, I'm the pastor. I should know, but if I don't, I'm expect, I can't expect any of you to know. Okay. But sometime in sometime in September, we're having a testimony night. Thursday the 15th, we're having a testimony night. I invite you all to come out. But come out, and I want some of you to come out with the intention of sharing the good news. Gospelizing, evangelizing. Not trying to witness to the people, but sharing the preaching, the good news of the word. The good news of what God has done for you. Each one of us should have a message, a lesson, a sermon prepared. Even if it's just 2 minutes, 30 seconds, 90 seconds, to share the good news of what God has done for you. The gospel, the good news of his word. I want to end on this. Ready? There's a rabbi and a soap maker. You ever hear this one? Okay. The rabbi and the soap maker. They were going for a walk, and as they're walking along, they're just looking at the city and looking at this world. And, take a stroll through Camden, take a stroll through Philadelphia, many of us probably had the same opinions as the soap maker. We were saying to the rabbi, what good is religion? What good is God's word? What good is religion and following after God when this is the world we live in? I mean, look, I don't even have to embellish this part. There's so much disgust and chaos on our streets. There's so much evilness and wickedness in this world. It's so much that's accepted. So much wickedness and evilness that's accepted just goes, that we become callous to it. And we just go through motion. And this is what the soap maker was saying to the rabbi. What good is God's word? What good is religion when there's this much evil, this much pain, this much suffering, this much wickedness? When the world is this destroyed, what good is God? And they continue to walk along. And then the rabbi looks over and sees a little boy playing in the mud. And the rabbi, like Jews do, can you believe this? What good is soap? What good is soap when there's so much dirty? This child is dirty. This child is filthy. And there's filthiness in my house. And there's filthiness in other people's homes. And there's so much filthiness and so much dirt and so much things that, so much infections and so much. What good is soap? And the soapmaker goes, Rabbi, you have to use the soap in order for it to work. And the rabbi says, and so it is with God's word. So it is with God's word. Far too often, we show up here. We go through the motions. Far too often, we go, God, what do you have in store for me this morning? Cry aloud. Jews, the daughters of Gamma. Okay? Let's get to it. And we don't understand that God is speaking to us through His Word, that God is speaking to us through His Holy Spirit, that there's so many benefits that come to those who know our Lord and Savior. There's so many benefits that come to those who are children of God. Before too often, we're just going through motions. So let's go preach the gospel. Go preach the good news of the Word as we allow God to work through us, as we encourage and strengthen, console and edify one another. Heavenly Father, we thank You for Your Word. Lord, we thank You for these truths. Lord, we thank You for Your Holy Spirit that speaks to us and strengthens us. Lord, we pray You continue to speak to us through Your Word as You continue to strengthen us through Your Spirit. So continue to use us to do Your bidding. Lord, remind us who needs encouragement, who needs a phone call, a text message, who needs prayer this week. Father, use us to comfort Your people. Use us to encourage. Use us to strengthen. Father, use Your Word to make an impact on our lives, on this body. We thank You. We thank You. Continue to use us. As we leave this place, Father, we pray that we continue to bring You the glory with the way we give up our lives. As we sacrifice and offer up ourselves, Father, let us bring You the glory You so deserve. Continue to bless as we continue to glorify. And we pray all these things in Jesus' name.
Okay, let's stand, shall we? Living for Jesus. Enter the world outside of these doors. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.